Hello friends, Yojana magazine of October 2017 is published and it deals with the topic of New India. So, PM on the occasion of 75th anniversary of Quit India movement has called for creating a New India which is free from open defecation, poverty, evils like corruption, terrorism, communalism and casteism. Chief editor has reiterated the same thing in the opening remark of the magazine, means opening editorial, and he also talked about champions of change. It is basically a synthesis, a dialogue, a connection between the entrepreneurs and the government regarding various initiatives. We will deal with these issues in detail one by one. First is related to creating a clean India. Creating a clean India, Swachh Bharat mission, and it has translated into a mass movement, a Jan Andolan. This movement was started on 15th August 2014 and the deadline was given as 2nd October 2019 when we will be celebrating the 150th birth anniversary of Gandhiji. Basically, you know, open defecation is an old age practice which causes at least 1 lakh death in the children, and we all know that this is clearly a behavioral issue and this can be prevented. There is not only deaths or unhygienic issues related to it, it directly translates into the economic loss of the country, and World Bank has estimated that 40% of the Indian children are stunted due to the lack of sanitation. So first it creates unhygienic condition gets translated into the health issues. When there is no proper health or health issues, there is a clear impact on the economic prosperity of the country, and the estimation is that around 6% GDP is lost due to this unhygienic, or you can say old age practice, which is of course an evil for the country as a whole. And not only this, it basically jeopardizes the dignity and the safety of our women. And this is the irony that on 25th century, when we talk about becoming a superpower, we are still in the clutches of open defecation kind of evil or orthodox practices. So this is the progress of Swachh Bharat mission. Five states: Sikkim, Himachal Pradesh, Kerala, Haryana and Uttarakhand. These states have declared themselves to be open defecation free. 2.35 lakhs villages are open defecation free, in which 4000 plus villages are there on the bank of Holy Ganges river, so they are open defecation free. So this is also impacting the cleanliness of Ganga. Then 55 crores people, rural India are open defecation free or out of open defecation. So this is the kind of magnitude or the impact that this mission has created. And so many campaigns were launched by Government of India, TV campaigns, involvement of the Bollywood celebrities, TV actresses and actors, sportsmen. So concerted efforts were made by Government of India, which has translated into the impact of 2.3 lakhs villages are open defecation free and 55 crores rural Indians are out of open defecation. So this is the direct impact you can see. Then what is so unique about this program? Why this program is unique and different from others? Earlier there was only focus on the output, means so many toilets are to be constructed, so many earlier the programs launched by earlier government talked only about the number of infrastructure created. Whereas this program not only talks about number of toilets made or lavatories made, it also talks about adoption by the people. So many people are open defecation free, or so many villages are open defecation free, so many villagers are out of open defecation. So this is the remarkable shift from the implementation point of view, or you know, the criteria at which the program is judged or evaluated. Then second is the process of verification. There is a stringent process of verification. It contains third party verification at district level, state level and national level. And Quality Council of India has also surveyed 140,000 villages and found that 91% were really open defecation free as a sample. So this program is actually making difference in the field. It also has a component of solid and liquid resource management. So solid and liquid resource management means dry and wet, or dry or liquid waste. So there is a clear differentiation between the earlier scheme and this scheme, which is causing the impact in the field. Then it has also created 20 iconic places which have cultural and historical significance, which will have rub off effect and create the replication on the other cities also. So currently in the list there are 20 iconic places, but 80 more places are to be included. Then there was a Swachh Bharat Hackathon. See, the government also duly acknowledges the fresh ideas by general public. In order to give the boost to the ongoing activities, it has organized Swachh Bharat Hackathon, in which it, you know, invited the solutions from the general public about scalability of these issues, challenging the issues at the national level, in the sense that what should be the sustainable solution for measuring the effect of the usage of the toilet, what should be the technology and method to leverage the technology to spark behavior is changed at scale. Then what should be the frugal toilet technology for difficult terrains, the places which are inaccessible by normal way, what should be the cost effective technology for that, what should be the solution for safe disposal of the menstrual waste or early and instant decomposition of the fecal matter. So these were the kind of questions that were addressed in the Swachh Bharat Hackathon, and these were the challenges, and it was expected by the people that the solution should not be on the pilot basis or limited to some set of villages. It should have a quality of getting replicated at pan India level, or the solution should be scalable. Scalable means it can be implemented at large scale. Then there was Swachhata Hi Seva. This was the campaign designed to create a direct impact in the ministries of the government, departments of the government, in which the officers from the top rank to the bottom rank participated and shown the way that how, you know, involvement of the people can make changes in the surrounding. And it was basically to give a message to the common people that you have to be responsible for your surrounding. Each one of us is responsible for our own surrounding, and it's the cleanliness is a kind of habit which cannot be left for others to follow. Every one of us has to follow this habit of cleanliness. This was the message that got replicated between 15 September to 2nd October, in which all the ministries and departments of the government of India participated wholeheartedly. So this was all about Swachh Bharat Mission and about its uniqueness. Now we will talk about Next article, which is enabling opportunities for rural India. See, when we talk about enabling opportunities for rural India, we talk about removing the poverty of the rural India. And being poverty free means enabling the social opportunities for deprived household so that they can come out of their destitution. See, if someone is in the clutches of the poverty, it means that there is no access for education, there is no access for health, there is no access for sanitation, drinking water, nutrition, food security, housing, gender equity, connectivity, and so many other problems. So in order to bring the person out of the trap of the poverty, it is very important to create these enabling social conditions. Once these conditions are created, it would enable or it would help that individual to come out of the trap of the poverty. In order to address this problem, the government is implementing Deen Dayal Antyodaya National Rural Livelihood Mission, DAYNRLM, and it basically addresses the multi-dimensional issue of poverty. And basically it is the states, it is individual state which has to take the responsibility for implementation of the scheme. And basic focus is on 8.85 crores household in the rural India. The scheme focuses them only. Then at next level, this article is written by Secretary of Department of Rural Development, and he talked about what kind of the intervention is being made by the department. First, the department is trying to establish the convergence between the other schemes with Antyodaya Yojana at scale, means replication at large level, implementation at large level. First, increasing the center spending to approximately double in 17-18, and the places where Antyodaya NRLM is being implemented has seen the increase in the bank loan compared to previous year. This point. Then there is a thrust on the skill development and placement. So enabling social opportunities means creating skill development training so that they are placed either in the wage employment or entrepreneurship. He also talked about Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Gramin, which is going to create 1 crore houses for rural areas. Then he talked about all weather pakka roads by March 2019. It should be connected, all villages should be connected, eligible rural habitations at least. And on top of it, if they are supported by National Food Security Act, definitely there would be significant dent in the poverty. And this is how he is trying to address the problem at scale. Then there is a thrust on the water conservation first and livelihood security through agriculture and allied activities. So different states have implemented different schemes of water conservation, such as Swavlamban Abhiyan, Jalyukt Shivir, water conservation initiatives in Maharashtra Mission, Kakatiya in Telangana, Dhoba Farm Pond in Jharkhand. So these are some of the initiatives taken by states for water conservation. Then he talked about that 60% of the Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme, 60% of the expenditure under this scheme is channelized towards agriculture and allied activities. So there are 4-5 allied activities of agriculture, that is AH, DD and F, animal husbandry, dairy development and fisheries. So first they are doing that. Then he says that there is a significant engagement of the citizens in these schemes. What is the benefit of engaging the citizenship in the scheme? First, there is accountability, because citizen himself is aware about the asset created or the provisions of the scheme, so he will question the immediate implementing agency at the village level or at the district level that look, so many funds have been released for the implementation of this scheme, where are the funds, where are the assets, then this scheme of NRLM is being implemented at the block level. Different blocks have been created, for example intensified, non-intensified blocks, participatory blocks, so many different blocks have been created. So cluster and panchayat facilitation teams are working in the identified backward blocks. Participatory approach is ensured in the planning based on the socio-economic caste census. Then there is a technology involved by providing apps like Meri Sadak, Awas Soft, etc. Public information campaigning is being done, cell phone based information system is ensured. So with these things, it is ensured that citizen is engaged and informed, so that the whole system is accountable. Accountability is ensured. Then he talks about transparency. Transparency is ensured by directly crediting the remuneration in the bank account, linking of bank account with Aadhaar, and installing micro ATMs at predetermined dates. So on such and such date, the person banking correspondence will visit with the micro ATM. So households are aware about the date and they will use the facility of micro ATM on that specific date. So transparency is ensured. Then use of effective technology means geotagging. For example, geotagging of assets is being done. Unique code is being generated. Places of the assets where the assets are being created are mapped, marked, pinned, so that everybody is aware that this asset is located here. And in case that asset is missing or there is a misinformation about that, the issue can be escalated to the next level or the issue can be flagged. So geotagging is also helping the scheme to bear the fruits of it. Then he also mentioned some of the points like bank loans for self-help group of women, speeding up connectivity, need-based skill updation, promoting innovation for transformation, evidence-based monitoring, implementation in the convergence mode. So these are the issues which have been tackled, or these are the method in which it is ensured that this DAY, Din Dayal Antyodaya Yojana, National Rural Livelihood Mission, achieves the intended objective with which it was implemented or with which it was conceptualized by Government of India. So this is all about removing the or enabling the rural India with the social opportunities. Enabling rural India with social opportunities. Okay, so moving on. Okay, so next article is related to farmer welfare, because without farmer welfare you cannot ensure that your 60% of the population is above poverty line or maybe performing good at the health indicators, economic indicators. So you have to take care of the 60% of the population, the people who are residing in the rural area, and the contribution of the agriculture in the GDP. So this is a striking fact that though there are so many people, majority of the population still lives in the rural India, dependent on the agriculture, but the contribution in the GDP is merely 13%. So it is an area where we need to pay our attention. Then because of this fact that so many people are involved and so many people are dependent, there is a high priority given to the agriculture sector, and strings of reforms have been channelized in past 3 years. The government has the objective of doubling the farmer income, and this is the striking difference between this government and the previous government. That previous government only talked about increasing the output, and the income part of the income of the farmer was completely missing in the policy line, policy guidelines. But this government has incorporated a key parameter for evaluating any policy, that any change or any intervention of the government in the agriculture sector should translate into the doubling of the farmers' income by 2022. And accordingly, the budget of the government has been increased by 24%, and definitely it has bore the fruit of it. Food grain production is nearly 2074 tons. Milk and fisheries production is also increasing by 21% and 17%. So milk production, India is number one, thanks to Dr. Kurian and National Dairy Development Board for replicating the model of Amul across India. And we need to ensure that our agricultural growth is reaching to 10.4% in coming years, which is currently at somewhere around 5% or 4%, 4 to 5%. It is ranging between 4 to 5%, should reach at around 10 to 11%. So we have to ensure that. Then what can we do? The government has already started a string of reforms. 7-point strategy has been formulated by Ministry of Agriculture and Farmer Welfare. The panel for doubling the farmers' income has been formed and submitted its report. So the government seems to be quite serious about the issue of doubling the farmers' income. And best strategy should be increasing the production, because without increasing the production, increasing the farmers' income is not possible. So farmers' income will be increased only if the production increases. So land is also limited, so production can only be increased only if we use the technology, only if we use the good variety of breed of seeds, or good breed of seeds. So we need to ensure that our farmer has access to the technology and it has access to the seed. Then we have to create an infrastructure also which brings the produce of the farmer from the farm gate to the market. And Prime Minister has initiated so many schemes. First is the Pradhan Mantri Krishi Sichai Yojana micro irrigation, increasing its fold from 4.3 lakh hectare in 2013 to 8.3 lakh in 2017. Soil health card is another scheme. Paramparagat Krishi Vikas Yojana, which is focusing on the organic farming. Then cluster has been formed for organic farming under Paramparagat Krishi Vikas Yojana. Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana has been launched at very low premium. So many reforms or so many policy decisions have been taken at the center, and they will definitely have some good impact or good effect in the field. This is also a very important point, you must note it. Most of you will be aware that National Agriculture Market has been created and 4010 mandis have been integrated with it. 13 states have launched a common e-platform for trading and transactions. So this is a significant move. And all these schemes, be it NAM or be it technology intervention or Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana or Pradhan Mantri Sichai Yojana, all these schemes needs to be implemented in a time bound manner in order to get the desired effect on the farmer's income. Okay, Niti Aayog has already given its paper on the doubling farmers' income on this issue, which has clearly raised the issue of providing technology to the farmer and raising the productivity per unit from the same amount of land, because land is limited, it cannot be increased. So where you can get the new varieties of seeds? ICAR is the apex research body. Indian Council of Agriculture Research has released nearly 600 improved varieties of seeds. So that would help. Then there are technologies like precision farming, integrated farming, resource conservation technology, protected cultivation, direct seeding of rice. So many technologies are there, but they will take their own time to get replicated in the field. So while the government is making all the efforts, there should be some efforts from the farmers also, from farmers' part also. And at least farmers should make themselves aware about integrated farming, because it is a farming which basically demands the resources, integrated planning of resources and the crop and the entire management, so that the input cost is minimized, the resource wastage is limited, and the maximum or the optimum result is achieved. So integrated farming means farming with proper, you know, resource planning and proper management, proper resource management. Then another concept is precision agriculture. Precision agriculture is the agriculture with the help of satellite and drones and a decision support system which can give you information about your field, its nutrient, its extent, and you can locate your field on the map also. So you see the direct map of your field with the help of satellite also, and you can precisely decide the you know, kind of fertilizers to be used, input to be used, and this way you can means whole farm management can be ensured and the results can be optimized. Then direct seeded rice is another technology that we, as we know that before you know, planting the rice, sapling is made ready. Saplings are planted in the field, but now different technology has been evolved and the rice can be seeded directly. So this saves the resources to a great extent, and it also reduces the water requirement of the crop. Then there is a concept of zero tillage. Zero tillage is a concept when you do not require to till the land, and in a way it does not disturb the soil nutrient through tillage. So zero tillage is another concept you must know, because UPSC has a habit of asking some of the questions, and if you have a very you know, very just a guess, or just a very you can say a faint idea about it, still it will work in the examination. So you, at least you must have a broad understanding about all these terms. For example, precision agriculture, it uses the drone, it uses the satellite, it uses all sorts of GPS, all sorts of scientific devices. You need not get into it that how it is actually done, but you must know what is the precision farming in a broader sense. Similarly, zero tillage means you do not have to till the soil. What are the advantages? That nutrients are not lost, it does not disturb the soil quality through the tillage. Then another concept is raised bed plantation. Raised bed plantation means you raise the level of the field at which you have to seed the samplings, and cropping is done very intensified manner, so that there is a no growth of weed. Weed is not there because there is a no place for weed. The roots of one plant is very near to another plant, but it should not be such that the leaves are touching each other. So the roots are near to each other, but the leaves does not touch, and in this way the weeds are avoided. Moisture of the water, moisture of the field is ensured and maintained, and thus the yield is very high. So raised bed plantation or ridge RIDGE, ridge plantation, is also another technology that is being widely used nowadays. You know, Israel is very advanced country as far as agricultural technology is concerned. So India and Israel have many MOUs as far as agriculture is concerned, for your information. Then crop intensity is another technological sound option for raising the income, because see, land is limited. Niti Aayog has already given its paper the technology and the productivity. So intensifying the crop is just the solution we can't avoid if we have to increase the output. So intensifying the crop, integrated farming, another technological, integrated farming, diversification towards high value fruit and vegetables with fiber content, species, medicinal plant, aromatic plants offer a scope to improve farmers' income. This point is very important. Means the farmer does not dependent on the conventional way of doing agriculture. If he keeps on depending on the conventional way of doing agriculture, in the event of flood or in the event of drought, he will be hit the severest. So he has to diversify so that he does not bear the impact to that level when he encounters extreme weather conditions. And allied activities such as forestry, processing of agriculture produce, animal husbandry, dairying and fishing should also be promoted. And definitely these are the point of 7-point strategy of Ministry of Agriculture. So Niti Aayog has suggested the shifting the burden from agriculture to other areas, because there is a disguised unemployment. More than one people is required where the job is sufficient for one person. So this is disguised unemployment. More than the required amount of people are there in the same job. If the job can be done by 4 people, 7 people are involved in the job. This is disguised unemployment in the agriculture. So the pressure has to be, burden has to be shifted to other sectors. The government is also already doing skill development, and past schemes income part was missing. Now the government is focusing on the income part of the farmers, and parity should be created between the farm and non-farm activities, those who are working on the farm and those who are non-farm, you know, working in the non-farm sectors. So if we are able to establish the parity between these two sectors, I think the we will be able to create a significant impact in the field. Next is champions of change. Who are the champions of change, by the way? The one who brings the change is the champion of change, and changes would be brought by them who will have a new idea. So the article talks about entrepreneurs, young entrepreneurs who have fresh idea, who has different ideas, who have out of box thinking, and it talks about establishing a dialogue with the government of India directly, so that the policy implementation is improved, policy formulation is improved. Because by having a 360 degree view of the challenges being faced by these entrepreneurs is the only way in which we can create our India as a new India. Because until unless we have 360 degree view of the challenges, we don't know what are the issues in the field. We don't know. The government is busy in making the policy, does not bother about the feedback. So what is the mechanism of feedback? When you have some kind of, you know, connection between those who are facing your policy, then only you can have a feedback. So this is the good scheme, because it is actually establishing the dialogue between the government and the entrepreneur who is actually facing the issue. Because in this way, 360 degree view of the challenges and issues are reported to the government, and it basically nurtures curiosity, creativity, imagination of the youth, and it helps them to achieve the dream of New India. This government, author says, has been a disruptive adopting a disruptive governance model, because it outlawed or it scrapped 1000 200 odd laws which were unnecessary. It increased the fold of banking and financial services by Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana, providing opportunities to do business through government e-marketplace. It included the unbankable people. It included, it supported the startups. So this government is different from all other government as far as the disruptive governance model is concerned. The government has a target of cultivating 10 lakh children as an innovator of tomorrow. And you must have heard about Atal Tinkering Lab. What is Atal Tinkering Lab? This lab, around 9,000 to 1,000 labs are established in the country, which covers around 55% of the districts of the country. And they give you the access to the state of art technology, 3D printing, robotics, and whatnot. All sorts of cutting edge technology is there. The equipments are there, and school going children between 6 to 12 are given access to these labs, and they can give you solution for simple problems. They give you different solutions in a different manner, which is simple solution but effective solutions. So this is how things are changing. Then he also talks about the government has also supported national intellectual property right policy, Startup India, Make in India, Champions of Change, Niti Aayog, and Digital Economy are some of the initiative of the government which are actually helping the innovation and creativity. Science, Technology, Engineering and Math, STEM. Science, Technology, Engineering and Math were supported by Dr. Kalam, because Kalam said that these subjects directly impact the creativity of the individual or children. Let them enjoy the creativity. Let them learn the importance of these subjects. Do not condition them with the preconceived notions. Let them experience and let them develop their own ideas. This was the thinking of Dr. Kalam for science, technology, engineering and math subjects. I have already told about Atal Tinkering Lab. 900 tinkering labs are there. Covers 55% of this district. Around 1300 more labs would be needed to cover all the districts of India. Okay, so Atal Tinkering Lab is a good initiative. So skill development, next topic, skill development. We know we are lagging behind in terms of skill development. When we compare our country with the rest of countries of the world, we say that we are having an edge over them because we have got the youngest population. We have got demographic dividend because our 15 to 59 year, age group of 15 to 59 year constitute around 63% of the population. So we are very young population. But the striking fact is that when we compare the country with the countries like Japan, Finland, South Korea, we find that their workforce is vocationally trained. Their workforce is vocationally trained. Around 90% of their workforce is vocationally trained. But in our case, it is just 2 to 3% of the workforce which is involved in the manufacturing sector is trained. The rest 95% or maybe 90% are involved in the unorganized sector without any vocational training. So this is the irony. Half of our country's labor force is self-employed and 93% of them work in unorganized sector. So what are the issues? Issues is that we do not have employment first, and we do not have skills. So we need to create employment on the one hand, And second, we need to create the employability skill set on the other hand, and this should go hand in hand. Then only we can address the issue of the employment first and skill. Skill deficit in the sense that we do not have institutions properly equipped to train the people. We do not have funds. There are high dropouts and lack of vocational training. Vocational training such as ITI, Polytechnic or management institutes. So there are issues, and I have covered it in detail in my September Kurukshetra magazine. September Kurukshetra magazine, the topic for which is skilling rural India. So it talks about skilling in detail. So this is the issue, that we do not have vocational training, and vocational training is considered as a fallback option, so on and so forth. We do not have trained staff, we do not have infrastructure, we do not have funds, and we do not have jobs. So many issues are intertwined with each other that it is actually, you know, vocational training is absent in the country, absent in the country. Okay, so we have to ensure that our demographic dividend should not turn into the demographic disaster. Our demographic dividend should not turn into the demographic disaster. The government is coming up with the Skill India program. Ministry of Skill Development and Entrepreneurship is set up in 2014. So many schemes like Deen Dayal Upadhyay Gramin Kaushal Yojana and Pradhan Mantri Kaushal Vikas Yojana, National this center, National Skill Development Corporation. So many institutes are being funded and supported now. The government is also revamping the ITI industrial training institutes. Incubation centers are being set up in the universities. And this point we can incorporate here, that India is one of the highest school going population. So 1.5 million schools and 315 million school going children are there in the India. So if we can introduce the orientation part in the school itself, we can make a significant impact in the entrepreneurship and in the skill sets of the Indian youth. And this is some of the data. 15 to 59 years, 62%, and 90% workforce in the unorganized sector. 25 crore job needs to be created by 2050. 50 crore people needs to be trained in the skill mission. So this is all about skill development. Next is role of women in New India by 2022. So I will cover it in a very quick, or maybe in a very short manner, because you know, this is the essay. There is no very critical analysis in this editorial. Pradhan Mantri, first of all, is putting a lot of thrust on the women empowerment. Old schemes are being fine-tuned to include more women in the fold, whereas the new schemes are primarily designed in such a way that they are focusing inclusion of more women. Then Constitution of India also ensures that the women get their dues in the all these spheres of the society. First, it talks about the Article 14, right to equality, 15, no discrimination by state, 16, right to opportunity, equality of opportunity, 39D, equal pay for equal work. 15.3 talks about special provision should be made by state for women and children. 51A, renouncing the practices derogatory to the dignity of the woman. And 42 talks about provision made by states for securing just and human condition for work and maternity. So you can see that Constitution itself gives lot of thrust for women empowerment and participation of women in the workforce. so that there is an egalitarian development of the society. Second, we need to see that apart from constitution, if we don't give them economic benefits or economic freedom, the constitutional provisions will not be sufficient. So we need to give them economic freedom as well. So in order to give them economic benefit, we need to bring them under the workforce. And if they want to be under the workforce or productive workforce, they need to be trained. Without skill sets, they cannot be included in the productive. So they need to be trained. So skill improvement and skill training. Then the government of India is actually designing so many programs which is emphasizing on the empowerment of the women. And we need to think one thing, that most of the women are not paid for their work, at least for their household work they are not paid. So once it impacts the economy in two ways. First, that their social status is not improved, and second, the since it is not monetized, their work is not monetized, it does not reflect in the GDP figures. So some action should be required for changing the situation. So the what is empowerment is about choices and their ability to exercise the choices. So they need to be brought under the policy making. Accordingly, 73rd and 74th amendment of 92 ensure that they are there at the district level and panchayat level, but at national level that bill is still pending. So this is one thing where we can see that things are not changing at the national level. They are not getting their dues. They constitute around 48% of our total population. Separate Ministry of Women and Child Development has been carved out of HRD in 2006. National Commission of Women has been made, and India is also signatory to the large number of international covenants and conventions and all sorts of discrimination which is against the women. So such convention are addressing the discrimination, and India is a signatory to these conventions. See some of the striking facts you can see here. Women participation in the workforce is just 25.5%, lower than Somalia, which is 37%. So you can see 43% of working women in 15 to 59 work from the home, for which they don't get paid. So this is also one area where we can focus, that this is the problem. We can suggest some of the solutions for that. Gender responsive budgeting is another area which has been addressed by the government. Earlier there were no gender responsive budgeting. Now gender responsive budgeting has been made. It has basically implemented two type of scheme where 100% provision is there and 30% provision is there. And 17 states have so far adopted gender budgeting, which is a good move. India has jumped from 20 jumped to 87th global gap index, gender gap index, in 2016 to the World Economic Forum. According to the World Economic Forum, a jump of 21 places from 2015, so it has improved. So this needs to be appreciated. Second point is that where as far as health is concerned, the woman health indicator is not doing well. India ranked 142, which is third from the bottom. So highlighted the need for increasing the funding to improve this health condition of the women of India. So the policy seems all good, everything hunky and dory on the paper, but does not reflect the same high reflection, high progress which is there on the paper. It does not gets reflected in the ground, or at least at not that advanced stage. एंड मिनिस्ट्री इज़ रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर बेटी बचाओ बेटी पढ़ाओ, इंटीग्रेटेड चाइल्ड डेवलपमेंट सर्विसेज, नेशनल न्यूट्रिशन मिशन एट्सेट्रा. सो इन ऑर्डर टू इफेक्टिवली मॉनिटर दिस स्कीम, जेंडर बजटिंग बिकम्स ए मस्ट बिकॉज मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ वुमेन एंड चाइल्ड डेवलपमेंट इज़ दे आर मॉनिटरिंग सो मेनी स्कीम्स. इट रिक्वायर्स फंड एंड विदाउट फंड इट कैन नॉट फंक्शन. सो जेंडर रिस्पॉन्सिबल बजटिंग शुड बी देयर एंड वी नीड टू इंश्योर दैट we give proper education to girl child, we avoid discrimination in the employment and wage differentiation is abolished. So corruption free India. First of all, this government is no nonsense government. The author wants to say that it has implemented so many schemes: Digital India, Make in India, Jan Dhan, Aadhaar, and Enam, MEP. So many schemes are implemented by this government, which is directly targeting transparency and ultimately reduction in the corruption of the country. The slogan of the government is that minimum government, maximum governance. Institutions like CVC and CAG is there, Judges Inquiry Act is there, Lokpal and Lok Ayukta Act is there, Smart Government, Jan Dhan Aadhaar Mobile, merger of railway budget in order to ensure that there are proper resources, goods and service tax is there. So ultimately the government is trying to ensure the transparency in the governance, which will help in reduction of the corruption. Okay, so this was the topic all about. There is no much analysis, so I am just putting it in a nutshell. Okay, then casteism free India. Casteism free India means social stratification. Social stratification. Caste is nothing but a social stratification. Casteism occurs when one part, suppresses another part to that extent at which the benefits of other caste is at detrimental level. Means to the detriment of the other caste. One is dominating the other caste to the detriment of it. So that becomes the casteism. So origin can be traced to the 1871, when the first decennial census of British India was done. And further, this caste identity was hardened when 1901 and 1911 census was done. So that hardened the caste identities. Earlier than that, there was no, means caste identities existed, but they were not that clearly demarcated and visible in the society. But after this census, they got hardened because British has reserved certain, jobs especially for certain caste, and they use this strategy as divide and rule. And we need to see that we do not get emotionally swayed for casteism, because until unless we are rational, we will not be able to realize the benefit of true democracy. See, nowadays casteism may be getting eliminated slightly on the social arena, but it is getting into the political arena of the country. Caste politics is actually catching up, and the basic tenets of caste politics is our emotional thinking about our own belongingness to a particular caste. So we should be rational and we should educate, propagate the awareness and see that people are aware and they think beyond the caste, beyond the caste. And that is the democracy. If they can't think beyond caste, they will not be able to realize the benefits of the democracy. So if they want to realize the results or the benefits of the democracy, they have to be rational. Okay, so this is the last part of the analysis or the video. Northeast Diary. First of all, Northeast Calling Festival was organized in Delhi. The purpose of the festival was to promote food, art, music, and enlightening Delhi people about the northeastern state. So food, culture, clothing, music, everything was there at Northeast Calling Festival. Then Northeastern Venture Fund has been established by the Ministry of Northeastern Region. Venture Capital Fund is attracting the young entrepreneurs and startups. 60 proposals are there in the pipeline. Startup and Stand-Up India is providing a lot of benefit. And apart from this benefit of Startup and Stand-Up, there is a fund of Northeast Venture Capital to fund the young startups. So apart from, on top of it, on top of Startup and Stand-Up India, Northeast Venture Capital Fund. Then Japan International Coordination Forum and Northeast Ministry had a kind of understanding which basically focused on the connectivity, road network, disaster management, food processing, organic farming, B2B, people-to-people contact, and so on and so forth. So this was the Northeast Diary. Then the next is the Delhi Book Fair was organized, in which publication division participated. It was organized by Indian Trade Promotion Organization. Then the final news of this magazine was Bullet Train. 14 September 2017, this is very important. 14 September 2017, the foundation was led by Japanese PM Mr. Shinzo Abe and Indian PM for India. You know, this bullet train project. The name is Mumbai Ahmedabad High Speed Rail, MAHSR. Cost is 1,08,000 crores. The funding is very liberalized funding. Interest rate is 0.1%, that to be the moratorium period of 25 years. So it is virtually making this loan as a free. 80% of the total cost is financed by the Japan in the form of debt funding. So this is very beneficial funding, or very liberalized funding for the India. At a very beneficial terms, India will learn a lot. Department of Industrial Promotion and Japanese Export Trade Organization, DIPP, and JETRO are having MOUs. It is resulting into the active interaction between India and Japanese industry. Construction sector will get boost, 20,000 worker will get construction, and high speed rail training institutes will be established at Varodra. Will train 4,000 staffs in 3 years. 300 railway officers will be sent to Japan for training, and this will have impact on the transmission of the technology from one country to another country, means transaction of the technology. This will help India to get cutting-edge technology of Shinkansen. Shinkansen is the this technology is considered very safe and efficient. The delay is less than 1 minute, and it is highest, or maybe safest system with least delay. So this is a cutting-edge technology. Which India will have direct access to, and it will also replicate the same on the other clusters or other corridors like Chandigarh, Delhi, Nagpur, Mumbai, Bangalore, Chennai. So this will have a win-win effect for job creation as well as for Indian industries to learn skills. Okay, so this is all about bullet train. This will boost the economy as well, it is written. And this was all about the October 2017 Yojana. Hope you enjoyed this video. I have tried to cover so many issues. This magazine was full of data because it covered 6-7 areas for creating new India, and all the editorials were mostly written by the department personnel, so they had given their own account of status of the policy being implemented by the department. So waiting for your feedbacks. Thanks a lot.